So I'm here today to talk to you about anterior cervical decompression and fusion. There are different ways of achieving a pain-free nerve, and most of the time you don't need any kind of intervention, and simple painkillers, maybe anti-nerve pain painkillers, neuropathic pain agents will be effective. And for a huge proportion of people, the small disc prolapse that is causing this problem will resorb slightly, the irritated nerve will calm down and the pain will go. So for most patients, that's the end of the cycle and no further intervention is required. We may use injections, either the surgeon or radiologist or pain specialists, and that's a way of calming the situation down, buying some time essentially for a procedure to be avoided. And that's the key, is to try and avoid the surgery if we can. But some patients are then going to go on to need to have a procedure. There are fusion surgeries, there are disc replacements, and there are decompressions. The decompressions generally are carried out from the back of the spine. They're called a foraminotomy, and they can be quite effective. They allow motion, but they don't often deal with the disc itself. And so there is perhaps a question mark over the mid and long-term results of those, whether that disc keeps pushing onto the nerve, having space being made. So, but that is a good option in the hands of somebody who's an expert. That's something which one could have for this problem. And then there's been a long-standing argument between fusion and disc replacement surgery. And still, despite that being long-standing, the jury is out. Both procedures effectively work very similarly and the outcomes seem to be very similar. But the key is to free that nerve up. Surgical length of stay is very similar and the results functionally afterwards are very similar. But there is a theoretical benefit of the disc replacement that it protects the level above or the level below from degenerative change later down the line. So it's something to consider perhaps in a younger patient. So having had the surgery, there are risks. Obviously the cervical anatomy is quite complex. To go from the front of the spine, we have to sneak past essentially the main blood vessels, the carotid sheath. We also sneak past the esophagus and the trachea. Very, very, very rarely they can be injured, but that's incredibly rare. Quite commonly though, the esophagus can be disturbed in its function. So swallowing difficulties afterwards is quite common, usually self-limiting, and hoarseness also similarly quite common, but often self-limiting. In terms of the surgical risks from a nerve injury perspective, incredibly rare, but if a neurological injury happens, that may be full paralysis, which would be arm and leg dysfunction. I've personally never seen it, but it's obviously a devastating complication if it were to happen. Blood loss is usually really small, but those big blood vessels can be injured. Again, rare. And there are small rates of failure of fusion where other surgeries are required to back up that initial fusion procedure. But those are incredibly rare for a single level. Gets slightly more when you have to do more than one level, certainly three levels, then we are looking at extra adjuncts like plates to help create a better fusion. But those sort of procedures are more rare. And often we would look at going from the back of the spine to do such an extensive type of procedure. But otherwise, ACDF is generally a home next day type of operation. There are some people who will be doing them as day cases. If you're old or frail, you may need to be in hospital for a little while longer. But it's a well-tolerated procedure, minimal blood loss. And surgical time of perhaps an hour to 2 hours. Where required, it works really effectively and certainly from my perspective is one of my favorite operations. So after being discharged from hospital, you might wear a collar, or if you've been have a disc replacement in place or a plate, then you won't need a collar. You'll be able to walk around freely for the next 2 to 6 weeks and start progressing with your recovery anytime after that. Usually we'll do an x-ray at around the 6 week mark to make sure everything is still in place, and we'll follow up that x-ray to at least 6 months, maybe 12. Afterwards, once we're happy with your progress in terms of healing and either a bedding in of the disc replacement or of the fusion itself, then you can get back to full activity. And I've certainly had people go back to full sports activities after these sort of procedures without any restrictions after the event. Some of those have been major trauma operations where the patients have then gone on even to compete and win at badminton horse trials. So it's something which, although maybe a bit intimidating to the patient, actually the on effect is really relatively minor.